Good evening. You're very welcome. Thank you very much for coming in out of that lovely day to learn whether we've never had it so good or whether we've never had it so bad. As you'll know, the theme for our presentations and discussion today comes from something that Harold MacMillan said back in 1957. And it's very important to contextualize that after what we thought was a recession such as we'd never see again, a world war and a period of austerity. He concluded, or he went into an election campaign claiming, not in fact that we've never had it so good, but that, to be absolutely precise, most of our people never had it so good. So there's an interesting distributional caveat entered into the way he phrased it that didn't get carried over into the way it entered into popular discourse and memory. And it's also very striking to contrast that theme with however you want to construe the themes that were debated in the election that we've just had. There was nobody claiming that we've never had it so good in the political debate. It was a very much more defensive and negative rhetoric. So what's the evidence? What does the evidence show about to underpin what we should think about the last long period as to whether we have seen very marked and pretty deep-seated and continuous progress, or whether in fact that would be a very misleading characterization? And if we have seen so much progress, maybe the question is why is the discourse so very different? So I'm delighted to be able to introduce three speakers who are very well equipped to contribute and debate this topic, and I'll just tell you about them quite briefly. I should have said at the start, my name is Brian Nolan. I'm in the Department of Social Policy and also in the Institute for New Economic Thinking, where I lead a program on employment, equity, and growth. So who you're going to hear from, though, and I'm just holding the ring, is first of all Dr. Max Roser, who is a colleague at the Institute for New Economic Thinking, where his work focuses on inequality and growth, but also on a database which he has constructed from scratch and is an enormously impressive resource called Our World in Data, which you're going to hear about, which not only equips him to tell you about some long-term trends here today, but equips you to go home and pull up this database and interrogate it for yourselves and come up with your own answers. Secondly, we'll hear from Dr. Anders Sandberg, who's a James Martin Fellow at the Future of Humanity Institute and the Oxford Martin Programme on the impacts of future technology, which is a topic that we hear so much about. So his background is in computer science, neuroscience, and medical engineering, and that equips him very well to tackle the implications of technological change and tell us about them. And finally, Professor Robert Walker, who is a colleague at the Department of Social Policy here in Oxford, and his research interests focus centrally on poverty and social exclusion, recently in particular on poverty and shame and social exclusion, and on a range of issues around those. Robert has published more books than I could tell you about in the time we have available. So we're going to go in that order. I should just ask you to make sure your phones are off, tell you that the fire exit is at the back, and crucially, just remind you that there's a live webcast, so if you don't want to be in the live webcast, don't ask a question. So with that, with no further ado, I'll hand over to Max to talk us through our first presentation. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Brian. Thank you very much for coming over this afternoon. I take this title quite serious, How Does the World Today Compare to 1957, and try to give a very big picture overview about how the world has changed over these 58 years. That hopefully prepares then for what Anders and Robert have to say later. I chose five different topics. I have 10 minutes, so I better get going at these five different topics. First, I want to give a long-term perspective on how health improved over these over 200 years, going back all the way to 1800. And what you see here on a chart, it's maybe a bit of an unusual chart, is on the x-axis, the cumulative share of the world population. And then on this red line, I ordered the countries ascending by their life expectancy in 1800. So on the very left, you have the countries in 1800 with very low life expectancy, like India and also South Korea. And on the right, the countries that made some improvements by then, Belgium, Netherlands, USA, Germany, that have life expectancy of almost 40. But back then, no country in the world had a life expectancy of over 40 years. So the level is very low, but and the inequality across these countries is also very low. And if we fast forward to the time that was mentioned in the title, 1950, the world has changed, as you see here. Some countries on the very right made huge progress in terms of life expectancy. Norway, the US, Canada, Germany, all have countries of around 70 years in 1950, while other countries there on the left are still stuck in poor health and have life expectancies still of less than 40 years. And if we move back, if we move all the way to now and see the change over this period that is the topic for today's debate, then we see that the countries that were worst off back in 1950 made the most rapid progress and caught up with the best off countries, so that a lot of countries in the world now have a life expectancy of over 70 or 60 years, while still some countries, particularly in Africa, are stuck in relatively poor health. So the transition is from a low level with high equality to a rising level with very high inequality in 1950, back to less global health inequality in 2012, but a much higher global average life expectancy of now 70 years. So it more than doubled over these 200 years. And this is, as you probably know, due to massive changes in mortality patterns at a very young age. This is showing you child mortality over the last 200 years. It is always measured as the children dying before the age of five out of 1,000 live births. And you see that the level is around 300 or 400, sometimes even 500 children dying before they reach their fifth birthday. And then you see this long-term decline first in the rich countries and then other countries catching up. Countries that grew very fast, like South Korea after the Second World War, the period that we are discussing today, made very rapid progress and their life expectancy declined very rapidly. But it's not only due to changing mortality patterns at a young age. What this chart shows you is here for the UK, the increase in life expectancies for different ages. Usually we discuss the blue line at the bottom, life expectancy at birth, where you see this increase from around 40 years to now 81 years, but also at higher ages. For example, if you take a look at the red line in the middle, that's the life expectancy for a 30-year-old back in the 19th century, that was 63 years. Now it's up to 82 years. So mortality patterns changed throughout the population, and also over these last 50 years that are the main topic of today, health also improved at higher ages. To the second topic, power and violence, again, a very long-term view. This shows you 700 years of homicide data here. This is all from this website that Brian mentioned, Our World in Data, and often it surprised me quite a bit how good the data is. This is from a researcher at Cambridge who reconstructed these homicide rates over across Europe. Modern levels for homicide rates are around one per 100,000 per year, so one homicide in a town like Oxford, or one and a half. Back in the Middle Ages, that was 30 or 50 times higher. So we are at historically relatively low levels of interpersonal violence, and over the last 20 or 30 years, violence is falling here in Europe and also in the US, where homicide levels are around 4 or 5 now. From interpersonal violence to political systems. This shows you the number of democracies and autocracies over the course of modernity. Green are the number of democracies going back to 1800, and you see that over the second half of the 20th century, democracies increased hugely in number, while autocracies, shown in red, declined over the last 30 years, which is, I think, a very important aspect where we made progress in the world. This crossover point that you see here is of course, around the time of the breakdown of the Soviet Union. And that also had consequences for large-scale wars. We have pretty good data for since 1945 from Scandinavian researchers. And here I show the battle death rate over the period that we discussed today, where we see these ups and downs with the Korean War and then the Vietnam War and wars in Iraq, Iran in the 1880s and 90s and Afghanistan, but a long-term kind of decline of violence over this period, which is linked to the pattern that we saw before in democratization of the world. The third topic, a quick view on economic prosperity, and Brian mentioned that topic before. Inequality is an aspect where things have gotten worse in many countries over the last 50 years. This is showing you the share of total income going to the top 1%, much discussed data in the recent public debate. This is shown over the whole course of the 20th century, and in the left panel you see that in English-speaking countries, including the UK and the US at the very top, there was this reversal after the decline of inequality in the first half of the 20th century. Inequality is now back to levels where it was 100 years ago. But this is only true in some countries. Inequality has very different trends in different countries. On the right panel, you see the evolution of inequality in continental Europe and also in Japan, where after this long-term decline of inequality, there was only a modest increase in inequality over the recent period. Now from the state level, national level, to the global level, and again, long-term perspective here, this is the world income distribution over all world citizens. On the x-axis you find income, and on the y-axis you see the number of people in millions at each income level. In 1820, the world was still very poor. The bulk of the population lived at incomes that are lower than the poorest countries' income today. Madagascar, I plotted there, might be hard to see, has an income of $670, and the bulk of the population back then has an income that is lower than that, of course, adjusted for price changes over time. Fast forward to 1970, where the income distribution looked like this. It changed to this bimodal distribution, where we have one part of the world that is already rich, and another bigger part of the world that is still stuck in poverty. And the world has a bit of a higher level of income on average, or quite a bit, but is hugely unequal. And over the last 40 years now, we see that this income inequality in the world as a whole is decreasing, and we are back to a unimodal distribution that is shifted to the right, so that incomes on average are higher, while it's still true that the income inequality in the world is very high. If we look at this shift to the right, then we basically study what is happening to absolute poverty in the world, and this is graphed here over 200 years. There are some estimates that go back to the early 19th century. On the very left, it's 1820, and you see here that around 90% of the world population lived on income levels that are comparable to what we call today absolute poverty. Only a tiny elite is better off and has a slightly higher income. Then in 1950, I added the numbers, it's around two-thirds of the world that lived in absolute poverty. In 1980, we have the new measures from the World Bank, where it's slightly over half of the world population that lives in absolute poverty, and now Absolute poverty is falling faster than ever before, and we're down in the latest numbers to 17%. One quick note on why I think this is important. Here's a survey question from Gapminder, where they asked a representative sample in the US, in the last 20 years, the proportion of the world population living in extreme poverty has, and you see the answers given by the surveyed population. Two-thirds of the people think that world population, the share of world population has actually almost doubled, while you've just seen that it in fact has almost halved, and only 5% of the people surveyed here know that. And I think if we have this very negative view of the world and don't have a quantitative understanding of what is happening, then I think there's the risk that we turn cynic or get disillusioned about what is possible for our world. Nature is a much more difficult topic, and there's much to say. One chart that I wanted to show is the global death rate from natural catastrophes. So this shows you how many people die per 100,000 again in the world due to this list of natural catastrophes, and with rising incomes and prosperity, this has decreased hugely. A second aspect where we are not there where we wanted to be is deforestation. This shows you a long-term perspective on the estimated deforestation by type of forest. The pink is showing you tropical forests, and the green is showing you temperate forests. In temperate forests, there was a lot of deforestation in the past, of course, and in Europe and the US, this has been going down with the shift to fossil fuels, so that we deforest less, and actually forests are now increasing in these world regions. In tropical forests, it is now also decreasing over the period that we discussed today, but there's a lot of progress still to be made. And very last aspect, which also gives an outlook over the future, education. Over this period, of course, education increased hugely. The literacy rate back in 1950, I just looked that up, is around a third of the world. Now it is more than 80%. And if you want to see into the future a bit, I want to know how the world will evolve over the future, then I think this gives you some insight. This is a comparison of the literacy rate of the old population, 65 years and older, and of the young population on top. And in many countries, if you look at Africa or also the Middle East, then these orange and red countries show a literacy rate of less than 40% in many of these countries, and the young population has literacy rates that are comparable with the richest countries, around 80 or 90% in these blue shaded countries. And I think this should give us also some optimism for the future, when it is this young population that is taking over the control over our economies and political regimes, and will help to innovate over the next decades to come.
Hello. I decided, being a literal-minded person, to try to be somewhat literal and really focus on what was going on in 1957. So I immediately started reading back issues of Nature magazine. And it was interesting to see what was going on. And of course, the one thing that kind of dominated a lot of the papers was space and rockets and anything related to it. Because on the 4th of October 1957, and the Soviet Union sent up the Sputnik 1 satellite, the first artificial satellite. And in November the same year, Laika went up with Sputnik 2 and became the first animal to orbit the Earth. This was not just the first animal in the 20th century, but the first animal since Earth's formation, if we ignore some bacteria maybe or meteors or something like that. So basically this was the dawn of a space age and everybody were aware of it. In America, this led to the Sputnik moment where people realized that, we haven't been able to launch our Vanguard satellite yet. We're in trouble. We need to really focus on science and technology. It inspired people to really start going for space. And it was pretty obvious to anybody that the future is going to be space. So where are we now? Well, we come rather far, actually. So Voyager 1 is now 19 billion kilometers away from Earth. It has actually been traveling for 60% of the time between now and 1957. And of course, we actually put people on the moon. It's also interesting to notice that the last astronaut to leave the surface of the moon left closer to 1957 than to the present. We haven't sent people to the moon ever since. On the other hand, Earth is surrounded by an enormous cloud of satellites. We have several thousand satellites and innumerable pieces of various space debris. And the impact has been very different from what people imagined back in 57. Back in 57, it was pretty obvious that, of course, we're going to go to space and explore and build. It was very much of a colonial project. The idea that the real commercial application of space was communication satellites was not obvious to many people. The idea that we might go to the moon and then not go back there would also have seemed very, very strange. In retrospect, it was very clear that the space program was entangled in the Cold War dynamics and might have been kind of overshooting it. It achieved enormous things in 17 years, but actually there was not so much impetus for it. But on the other hand, we also got the environmental impact of this picture, realizing that Earth is a system that is very rare, that's very unique, has had a profound cultural impact ever since. Many people have described this as one of the most important pictures ever, simply because it affected our cultural understanding, which is very hard, of course, to put in your specification for a program, because it's never clear whether that you get that as an output. But jumping on, another thing that was big in 57 was, of course, atoms. The first commercial power from a nuclear power plant at Santa Susana in California came online, and you could cook with your friend the atom. And Ford was even proposing a concept car, the Ford Nucleon, which was nuclear powered. That never really went anywhere. But it's an interesting thing that, again, the nuclear age, it was so obvious to everybody that, of course, the future, whatever it's going to be nuclear. However, when we look at the graphs of the energy use, which I, of course, have borrowed from a certain site, the contribution of nuclear power, the kind of light green, is pretty minor. And it doesn't look like nuclear power has that roaring big future people believed back in the 50s. One reason might, of course, be have noticed already in 57, when in October 10, when the Windscale accident occurred here in the United Kingdom, that it's somewhat tricky to make safe nuclear reactors. I think it's entirely possible, but then they tend to become very expensive. And advanced reactors are very complex technological systems that are very hard to prove that they're safe and stable. So this has resulted in a bit of surprises about our nuclear age. Another thing that happened that year was the first Fortran compiler. So back before 1957, in order to program, you had to punch your cards yourself with machine code. Assuming you had a fancy computer that could read punched cards, sometimes you had to use strips of paper instead. Actually, my computer science teacher in high school had been part of that generation. He was limping even in old age because he had accidentally dropped a byte on his foot in the early 1950s. But now a solution had been found by IBM engineers. A very complex computer program filling a pretty big box that you gave instructions in a language which was understandable to humans, and this piece of software turned that into software that the computer could run. When you think about it, this is a machine programming itself. Yes, it's programming itself according to a program humans have painstakingly written, but it's a step forward. And ever since, we have built layer after layer. New compilers have been compiled by older compilers, and the machines have grown steadily way more complex. In fact, it's kind of unthinkable today to live in a world without computers. The code that is running in our computers is also unthinkably complex. A typical operating system today has several tens of millions of lines of code, many of which probably no human has ever seen, because they're linked in from libraries, and some of them are auto-generated, actually quite a lot of them, and we actually do not fully understand many of the complexities, which is, of course, why we're getting constant patches of the internet for our devices and the software, because we're finding security flaws and bugs all the time. And one of the reasons for this expansion has, of course, been the capacity expansion. Moore's law was not yet invented in 1957. That came a few years later, but it was still going on. If you measure how many computations you can do per second per dollar, it had been going up exponentially since at least the 1940s. It's important here to realize that the standard formulation of Moore's law, talking about transistors on silicon, is not very interesting. That's only interesting if you're in the semiconductor business. What we as humans actually care about is what we can do with our machines, and that is operations per second per dollar. So in this plot, I've been kind of playing around with the statistics, kind of let's assume it eventually levels off. Given the historical data, where will it level off? And I realize that it's kind of 99% chance that we're going to get more than 100,000 times more computation than we presently have. And that's the really pessimistic prediction. The top predictions, I simply cannot fathom what's going on there. And this, of course, has led to a lot of really interesting applications. Not just because computing has become more powerful, but because it can become smaller and cheaper. These are not cheap objects. The thing to the left is the Hamilton electric watch, also from 1957. And it was the first electric watch, and it could probably have one or two transistors. More than that wouldn't fit. Meanwhile, the Apple Watch, I don't know how many millions of, or billions of transistors it has, but basically it would correspond to a mainframe computer back in the 50s, of course. And it's, of course, also way more than just a timepiece. Both of them are, of course, status symbols intended to show off that you have the latest in technology, but the Apple Watch is also a form of communication. It can maintain your music, your exercise habits, and so on and so on. By getting computing cheaper, it also became possible to use it for many more applications. Applications that would have been totally unthinkable back in 57. Back in 57, people were actually doing slightly dirty pictures using teletype machines, but they couldn't imagine YouTube and sending cat videos over the internet. Partially because even envisioning an internet would have been very hard back then, because computers were isolated objects. Now we have reinvented them as something that's connected through a cloud everywhere. And over in biology, the central dogma was formulated in 57, or 56, depending on how you count. Francis Crick suggested this, and being an atheist, he completely flubbed the meaning of the word dogma, which in religion means, of course, something you need to believe in no matter what the evidence is. But Crick believed that dogma meant something you believe in without having any evidence. So he suggested this idea that it looks like DNA is turning into RNA, which then regulates the construction of proteins. Information flows that way, but not in the opposite way. That's what he called the central dogma, and the name stuck. Just like the Big Bang and black holes, whenever you coin a stupid name, it is guaranteed to stay around forever. Now, back then, we had just discovered the structure of DNA, and people have certainly noted that DNA can change through evolution. What has happened in the intervening time is, of course, that we learn to edit DNA, and we become very, very good at it. Today, it's possible to buy a DNA synthesizer on eBay, and if you're a student, you might want to participate in one of the synthetic biology challenges and hack together your own genomes and synthesize them and insert them into organisms. We're developing biobricks, modular components that can be inserted into genomes to do different things. And of course, the price of both sequencing DNA and making it has gone down exponentially again. And this is in turn having rather strong effects on biomedicine. So these four technologies, have really developed, but in directions that might be slightly surprising. I think the most important lesson is it's very hard to tell whether something is easy or hard before we have experience with it. Space turned out to be very easy from the start. Actually getting into space and putting people on the moon, that required a huge effort, but it was doable rather fast if you had the resources, but it was hard to stay in space. Nuclear power turned out to be relatively modestly simple to make something radioactive, hard to make it safe and acceptable to people. In the case of computers, it was surprisingly easy once you had software to have many people write software. And once you mass produced something to make it so cheap that everybody were accessing it, the markets became enormous and the economic interest in making more cool software grew without bounds. In the case of biotechnology, the real revolution was when we realized, oh, it's information processing. We can actually use our computers to do that. But what has held back many applications here are cultural issues. Many parts of Europe don't think that they want genetically modified organisms, although they're then eating their heirloom tomatoes, which are certainly very unlike anything you might find in nature. But again, a cultural shift, a political view on what the world ought to be, has affected the technology quite profoundly. So, are we better off? Well, we certainly seem to, have way more food. And the interesting thing about this graph is that it started going up well before we had any inkling about DNA. Just good crossing methods lead you quite far. The Green Revolution was also only partially about new crops. It was also better land use, better forms of irrigation. And that has led to a pretty profound increase in productivity. And the test yields, if you do everything perfectly right in a lab, then you get that green dot up there, which is frankly just ridiculous. But it's good to know they have that kind of margin. So that looks pretty good. When it comes to lifespan, I'm focusing on the later part of your graph here. We have seen an increase from of life expectancy from 70 to 80. And again, it's interesting to notice antibiotics, vaccinations, and public hygiene happened before 57. They have gotten better since. But what we have seen since 57, it's still debated how much is due to advanced biomedicine. It's probably less than the changes in lifestyle we have. The fact that we have better ways of handling nutrition, that we have better ways of avoiding accidents, that we smoke less and so on. And a lot of that is, of course, turned also to education. It's well worth recognizing that buying an encyclopedia in 57 was actually something costly for a middle-class family. Today, of course, you can either buy a really cheap online encyclopedia for a few pounds to get a DVD, assuming anybody still uses DVDs, or, of course, you go to Wikipedia like the rest of humanity. Wikipedia is not perfectly free. You still need to go online, but the cost is minuscule. And Wikipedia is just the tip of iceberg. An interested child can equally easily go to the Archive site, where the premier physicists of today are putting in preprints of the papers and just read them minutes after Stephen Hawking has put it there. So that looks pretty good. The problem is we have also been living through a rather scary period of time. There was 10,000 nuclear warheads in 1957, but you had to deliver them by hand, or rather by a bomber plane. But 57 also marks the time when we got the intercontinental ballistic missile. In fact, the R-7 rocket that got Sputnik into orbit, it was also the first Soviet missile. Because, after all, a missile is just an Earth-intersecting satellite. If you can do one, you can do the other. And since then, we've been through a very, very seriously scary period of time with things like the Cuban Missile Crisis, the Able Archer exercise in 1983, the Petrov incident, and numerous mishaps, both large and small, which actually may, I'm working on a paper right now about whether we actually are the lucky few survivors in some parts of the multiverse that are not on a radioactive ash pile. It's actually kind of surprising when you read the history that we managed to get through the Cold War as unscathed we were. The nice news here is, of course, that the stockpiles have been going down, which shows that risk doesn't necessarily have to increase over time. Right now, we are a bit more worried about biorisks. Right now, the risk from pandemics is probably lessened because we have good healthcare, but we also have good global communications. In 57, the Asian flu, a case of a bird flu crossing over to humans killed 150,000 people worldwide. And we're still worried about that. Plus, we have better biotechnology. So there are some researchers doing gain-of-function experiments, again, in order to figure out how these crossings of viruses happen in, so we can control them. But it means that in the lab, they are producing viruses that are pretty lethal and can easily be transmitted between humans. And remember that graph about how much it's getting easier to synthesize DNA, and you can see that we might be heading for a somewhat scary future. We might be increasing the existential risk even though we're getting safer. But we're also getting better at cooperating. This is the number of international treaties in different points of time. The red line is 1957. We went from 18 to, about 60 in the intervening time. Of course, international treaties are no evidence for international cooperation. But it seems like we have been on the increasing end of that. 57 marked the first international geophysical year where even the Soviet Union and America worked together to understand the Earth system. And that year probably also marked the real start of environmental movement in the sense of we actually want to monitor this planet and work together to keep it livable. Together with various forms of globalization networking, I think we actually have seen much better coordination. So my conclusion would be that the traditional view of the future, the 50s future where everything is streamlined and chromed, is very much based on this kind of linear idea. It's more the faster trains, more nuclear reactors, bigger airplanes. But what we have discovered is, of course, that actually more is different. We have found that the real challenge for modern technology is complexity. Is it possible to manage the new technology? Can we write software that's smart enough to handle our software? And the other challenge is, of course, the risk. So the missiles and the satellites are in the fruits of the same tree. The biotechnology that might give us bioweapons also gives us wonderful medication. The surveillance systems that threaten our privacy and maybe political freedom are also very good for actually staving off incipient global disasters. Artificial intelligence, which has had this, a lot of ups and downs over this period of time, the word was coined in 57, actually. No, 56. Right now might take our jobs and in the long run be a threat because it's too autonomous. But we can figure out solutions to this. We have done that in the past. I think that in general, there are three factors we need to care about. The technological ability, so we can do stuff. And then we need to have insight to know in what direction we want to go. And then we need the coordination to be able to actually do that together rather than pulling in different directions. And I hope to have shown that, yeah, since 57, we have become way better in technology. And I think we have become better in insight to some extent and into coordination. So I would argue that, yes, we never had it so good, but it can become way better. Thank you.
We have an impossible question to answer. It's just incredibly impressive how my two colleagues have set about addressing it. You know, we're dealing with, 59 years? We're dealing with all the countries in the world. We're meant to reach a conclusion. They've pulled together the latest statistics and told really fascinating stories in both cases. So what on earth can I do? Well, I'm going to approach it in possibly two ways, both of them being much more parochial, much more narrow than my colleagues have attempted to achieve, or indeed have achieved. I'm going to work on the one advantage that I have. I remember 1957 well. I remember what it was like to wake up in a house without central heating and scrape the ice off the door, off the windows to see out. I know what a house means when we haven't got a telephone, when we haven't got a fridge, when we haven't got a washing machine, or at least not an automatic washing machine. Our car at 57 was a three-wheeler, not three wheels, not four. It had a motorcycle engine of 175 cc's. It went, however, 90 miles per each gallon of petrol, but it didn't go more than 30 miles an hour going downhill with the wind behind us. So two possible possibilities in terms of addressing this question. One is, in a sense, to tell a story based on that direct experience. I could, for example, give you a story of my lifetime over that period of time and compare it with that of my father and that of my son and reach conclusions about who did best. And on balance, I think the conclusion would be that I did a lot better than my father, but I've also done a lot better than my son. An alternative strategy is to pick up on Brian's request to me, which was to say something provocative. Let's have some polemic. Let's get people talking. And that strategy would be to take two things which I think are profoundly worse, in two areas in which I think Britain in particular is profoundly worse than we were in 1957. Which of those should I do? Heads, I'll tell you the story of my life. Tails, I'll be provocative. Thankfully, it's provocative. So the areas that I would argue were much worse than we were in 1957 are, first of all, poverty and our treatment of people who experience poverty. And secondly, I'm going to argue that politics is a damn sight worse too. And I'm going to suggest that those two things are not mutually exclusive at all, but combine to tell that particular story. So let's go back to Harold MacMillan, 1957. 1959 was the election that followed from this notion of we've never had it so good. And in the foreword to that election manifesto, Harold wrote the words, "I do not remember any period in my lifetime when the economy has been more sound and the prosperity of our people at home so widely spread." And he was probably right. The Gini coefficient, a measure of income inequality in society, at that point was 0.23. Zero is absolute equality. One is absolute inequality, where one person holds all the wealth that's there. So 0.23 is quite low, and it was low by international standards. It was 0.25 by the end of the 1960s. It was about 0.26 in 1979. So that in 20 years or so, inequality did not, broadly speaking, increase in Britain. It remained low. But by 1993, the Gini coefficient was 0.38. It's now about 0.383, having reached 0.40 in the late 2000s. Those figures are high, clearly relative to 1957, but they're also high in international terms. Howard also wrote in that front piece to the manifesto, "By rising living standards and by social reform, we are succeeding in creating one nation at home, one nation conservatism." In 1957, there were no food banks in Britain. In fact, there were no food banks anywhere in the world. They were invented in 1967 in Phoenix, Arizona. In 1957, as far as we can calculate, relative poverty in Britain, that's 60% of median income, was less than 13%. In 1979, well, 20 years later again, 22 years later, it was virtually the same, 13.7%. By 1993, it was over 25% and is never again at any point fallen below 20%. So poverty is considerably higher in Britain now than it was then. And the food banks were not needed because poverty was in fact lower and because unemployment too particularly was lower. What's more, the state, us, had systems in place to deal with exceptional needs and exceptional circumstances. And why was this? Well, because I think politicians sought different goals and society as a whole sought different goals, perhaps a touch more collective than currently we do. Again, moving on from the frontispiece of the manifesto to the core. The core manifesto objectives that the Tories were giving us in 1959. We shall continue to ensure that those dependent on social assistance, what we nowadays call welfare, shall have a share in the country's increasing prosperity. We will improve welfare. And we pledge ourselves to ensure that pensioners continue to share the good things which a steadily expanding economy will bring. 57, Tory manifesto. By 1985-1986, Norman Fowler reforms of welfare, the heart of the Thatcher era, had changed changed the concept of what we were about. Social Security, welfare, was now a burden. Indeed, it was responsible for a major share of the current heavy tax burden on individuals and companies. That concern about that pressure on tax justified a cap on spending. So those exceptional needs payments that I was talking about, which were once grants, became loans. And the system that was put in place, welfare, was claimed to be creating traps, traps which made people worse off in work than they were when they were unemployed. And this therefore created the leitmotif of disincentives. The fact that welfare stops people working, encourages them to have a lazy life. That leitmotif underpins the current reforms of welfare and the introduction of universal credit. Fowler was clear that need was not enough. The need had to be genuine, implying that much need, and many of the claimants were in fact not genuine. The pledge earlier I'd referred to in relation to pensioners, was also at an end. And it was at an end because many pensioners were as well off as workers and their families. What's wrong with pensioners being as well off as, family, as with families with children? There's obviously a cost attached to that, but what's the moral justification for expecting pensioners to have lower incomes than the rest of us? So we've had a fundamental shift in terms of the way that we understood the nature of poverty and indeed the policy responses to that. A decade later, under the major government, unemployment benefit was abolished and replaced by job seekers allowance. That happened after a period in which in the previous 3 years, unemployment had more than doubled, a reaction to what was seen as an impending crisis. The benefits were cut. The contribution principle that you pay and you get out what you pay in was devalued. And the rhetoric that was emphasized underpinning this change was the notion of shirking and of fraud and the need to sanction people in order to get them to work. In that process, it served to demonize not only those people who were shirkers, but those who were receiving unemployment benefits, everybody who was unemployed. And that was something that the British public, urged on, I guess, by the popular press, found rather easy to do, to demonize those who are unemployed. And while Major presented Social Security as the problem, New Labour, they saw it as a constraint on the positive things that they wanted to achieve through increasing public expenditure, through increasing spending. So they sought to make welfare popular. However, they did not seek to challenge the language of the shirker or scrounger. They found in their focus groups that that thinking had already been hardwired into public perceptions. No, rather than challenge it, they sought to incorporate it into the logic of what they were trying to do, to exploit it in the language of welfare to work, from bad welfare to good work, juxtaposing rights against responsibilities for which you might read irresponsible, you're not working. And in so doing, reinforced the growing notion of scapegoating and othering those who are on benefits. In a sense, the good and the bad and the ugly. So New Labour didn't challenge the ideas that had gone before, but built upon them. They both pandered to populist views in the hope of electoral gain, but then so doing, they also ratcheted up the stigma felt by all those who were needing to be reliant on state welfare. So Labour's legacy was to confound the social problem of poverty with the political problem of spending on welfare, and also to add further to the confusion in the public's mind about what was cause and what was effect. Was welfare causing poverty, or welfare a reaction to poverty that was existing? And that confusion was a great gift to the incoming coalition, with a welfare reform led with missionary zeal, I think, by IDS, by Ian Duncan Smith, who comes from the so-called compassionate right. For him, passionately believed, I know I've spoken to him on many occasions, it's his profound belief that welfare spending is the cause of what he calls broken Britain. The language found in focus groups became the language of government white papers. Worklessness, dependency, were presented as engendering a sense of hopelessness and low expectations. That in turn breeds were the word that was included in the white paper, breeds intergenerational poverty, like rats, I guess. And the solution to this problem was to return to the leitmotif that we came upon initially under the words and ideas of Norman Fowler, a return to the notion of disincentives, and therefore to create a welfare system that always give the right system, that would lead the rats in the maze to do the right thing. In other words, to work. The time taken to design and implement universal credit has taken the edge off the impact of the welfare cuts. But as we look to the future, I would encourage you to count the number of food banks as we go into the years ahead. So poverty has more than doubled since 1957. And the psychological toll attaching to poverty, I would argue, is a great deal greater. Anyone who is in poverty feels that they have not done justice to themselves. Every parent who looks into the eyes of the child that they know they cannot feed knows that they have failed, even if they simultaneously know that their failure is structural, that it results from limited opportunity and from power structures that exclude and exploit them. But they know in their hearts that they have failed their child. But today, they are repeatedly told by politicians, the media, and others that not only are they failures, but are also dishonest, lazy, and parasitic. They are both the epitome of Britain's failings and the cause of Britain's lack of success. They are a drain on society and the principal reasons why our taxes are too high. They, the poor, a pretty derogatory term when you think about it, they, the poor, make me, the voter, poorer. So people in poverty, I'm arguing, are collateral damage in a political system in which politicians now know how to get elected. Social science has given them the equipment to do so. It has given them the focus group. They now know how the median voter, the person likely to switch allegiance, how they think and how they speak. And the parties compete with words and with policies that pander to the prejudices of this group. The group who believe that their success is a product of their hard work, their intelligence, their self-sacrifice, and that their success is limited only by the constraints imposed by government, by high taxes, and by shirkers, those people who are on benefit. Politicians competing in this way through the press and media fuel the social myths around policy and politics and create and reinforce social divisions in our society. Divisions between hard-working families on the one hand and the remainder, the social scum, benefits street. Escalating this language of abuse that also conveniently sells popular newspapers. In doing this, they have created a spiral of hardening attitudes of us and them, the other, such that it is impossible now to make welfare popular. Idealism, any notion of a common good, is nowhere to be seen. Rather, it is simply, vote for me and you will have more to spend on yourself. So if politicians know how to win elections, why did Miliband fail so badly? Lots of reasons, of course, too complicated for me to cover them or even to understand many of them. And of course, the Labour Party are desperately trying to find out. But I think among them was the suspicion that behind the rhetoric of hard-working families designed to play so well with the median voter, there was the sense that Miliband was up to no good. Although he wouldn't say it, they suspected that he was soft on welfare, that he actually wanted to assist people on poverty, shirkers, that is, rather than to punish them. After all, Labour had ruined the economy by bringing the poverty rate down from 25% to 20%. In Britain, in this respect, in respect to our treatment of people in poverty, our policy responses to them, the language that we use, and the basis of our political system, why we vote, I would argue, are profoundly worse than they were in 1957. If we cannot have socialism, and how many of us are prepared to admit that we would like it? If we cannot have socialism, I would prefer Macmillan's One Nation conservatism, and perhaps even that of Disraeli, to Cameron's promise on Friday morning to govern as a party of one nation, one United Kingdom. That was addressed to Scotland, not to the people I care about, who habit the bottom of our society.
I'd like to thank our three speakers very warmly indeed on your behalf for three very stimulating, very thought-provoking, somewhat different, and all the better for that, presentations. And at this stage, I'd like to open it up to the floor to both give you the opportunity to make relevant points succinctly, hopefully, and to take up points mentioned by our speakers and look for elaboration or clarification or just plain disagree. I see a hand just here. Yep.
I'd like to ask. I'd like to ask Professor Walker a question, because I'm very, very sympathetic to the general view that you put. But I'd like to know what you think of this theory, which is that welfare grew. Let me go back a bit. One thing that was very different in 1957 than now is the population is almost entirely white. And welfare grew in North America and all over Europe, actually, in the 50s and 60s in essentially homogeneous, however you want to pronounce it, societies. As immigration grew, the theory is that's what actually put the skids under the growth of the welfare state, because people are prepared to tax themselves for people who are like themselves, but not for people who are strangers. And I just wonder what you think of that as an explanation of what's happening.
So we'll take two or three questions, and then just here.
I've got two, one point and one question, I guess. The question really was how people having it so good in 1957, and are we still the same or better now? We haven't really talked about the definition of good. And quite often people would say good is health and happiness. And I would like to ask the panel about happiness, because I think that's a very important measure of whether people have improved or not. And I think there has been some work done which shows really that material wealth makes no difference to happiness unless you're at or below the poverty level, in which case, if you're raised above the poverty level, your happiness has increased. The other point I wanted to make is about is what has happened in those 59 years. And one thing that has changed significantly, and I, like you, I was 9 in 1957, and I didn't have a fridge or a washing machine or central heating. And at that time, of course, a lot of people had outside loos or shared loos. And that's changed, always considerably. But the point I wanted to make is community. I think that's an area that has gone down significantly. The feeling of community, civil society, people participating in improving the life of others or their group or their family, or etc.
Thank you very much. Can we just take one more? I just see a hand down the back there in the window.
Thank you very much for all of those. I had a question for Max and the wonderful data. I wondered whether it might be possible for you in future not just to look at income, but look at debt and wealth as well. Because all those farmers in India who've seen their income rise over $1.25 a day have seen their debts rise much higher, which is why thousands of them are killing themselves. Worldwide, as far as I can understand it, wealth is being concentrated in the hands of a smaller and smaller group. The proportion of global wealth is being concentrated in the hands of a smaller and smaller group. And debts are rising among other people. My parents were students here just after 1957. They didn't have a huge amount, but they had absolutely no debt, whereas you lot have got debt. We promise you amazing incomes in the future, but I'm afraid you're not all going to get it. So can we worldwide and for Britain, rather than just look at income, look at debts and wealth as well, and the obligations that those in debt are going to have to work for those who've got wealth?
Thanks, Danny. Okay, I'll ask Robert to respond to give Max time to formulate his answer to that.
Yes, I had 7 years of government grants as a student, and I managed to save over that time a deposit for a house. My grant income was the same as my loans that my son accumulated over what turned out in his case to be 19 years of post-school education. Maybe he's a shirker. The notion of debt is crucially important, I agree with you. You cite India and farmers killing themselves. The intersection between phenomena of that sort and policy are often unpredictable. One of the causes of those high suicides is a recognition that they were taking place, and therefore we in a sense need to compensate those families for the loss of the farmer who committed suicide when confronted with the fact that he couldn't feed his family. There is some evidence to suggest that farmers are now under pressure from their families to commit suicide so they can receive the cash benefits that would follow as a result. The notion of community, has it declined over time? I think it possibly has. Certainly, when you go back to the sociology of the 1960s and 70s in Britain, there were, and particularly working class communities, there was a great deal of dense networks. Many, many of them, however, were networks between families. There's a sort of quite a lot of confusion between whether they were families and whether they were neighbours and friends that were the basis of the community. But a lot of evidence suggests that it was families, because families are much smaller and we've broken them up with the processes of migration. I also think it's intriguing where the internet comes in the notion of a community. Those of us who are lucky to be involved in the internet have a community that is much broader in spatial terms than it once was. Health and happiness, very, very difficult to conceptualise and measure. Is it happiness of the moment, or is it an ongoing sense of well-being? And I think there's confusion in the data. There's certainly sort of evidence that income, as you indicated, that at some point there's a tailing off between reported happiness and income. So give them more money, they're not more happy. The reverse of that, I guess, is the sort of presumption that people in poverty should be sad. You know, they should suffer, that poverty is about suffering. Well, you know, kids and families in poverty live their lives. They find happiness where they can find happiness, as you and I find happiness. So it's an odd sort of thing to think about whether, in a sense, happiness should be so directly related to income. And the theory about whether immigration has changed our allegiance, changed our notion of community. We're prepared to give to people who look like us. You know, that's the basis of why you find that attachment with the child is born. Your child is born. You see yourself in their eyes and in their face, and you respond with that commitment. You're going to protect them for the rest of your life. If they turn out to be the colour that you weren't expecting, that becomes a problem in the paternity ward. And so it is, perhaps, in terms of the things that you were suggesting, that we have a much more heterogeneous society, which makes me not give up. It gives me a possible explanation, but it gives us a new mission, doesn't it? To build a community out of different colours, out of people who operate and think differently. But that's not the way our politics has gone. What we had was a consumer election. We didn't have an election that thought about community. When you went into the booth, what were you thinking about? That your vote would benefit somebody else or yourself?
Max. Yeah, maybe I just pick up what Robert just mentioned. Like I try to portray this global perspective, and I think one aspect where the sense of community really increased and also increased here in the UK is the sense of a global community. So while I completely agree that we have to do much more and can't accept the poverty levels here in the UK or in other rich countries, I think we very much realized over these 50 years, or probably more my parents than me, that we can and have to do something about the global inequality that there was and still is. So in the UK, we have charitable donations going up for decades, and I think that's a clear sign that this sense has increased. Then there was this question about the link between prosperity and happiness, and I think the empirical research now is very clear that there is a very strong link between prosperity and like individual income and happiness of individuals, and also across countries that people in richer countries report higher levels of happiness. There is some discussion, as you said, about whether there's a point where this levels off, but I think it's clearly very much higher than levels of poverty. There's like a famous number that is based on this Kahneman and Deaton paper, cites $70,000 US dollar as the point where this levels off. But I think this is now very clear, and there was some debate on whether this link is true through time, so that as incomes in a country grow, that the happiness in the country increases. And now we have better data that asks the same standardized survey questions over time, and I think also there the current research rather suggests that there is a strong link also over time. And then there was this question about wealth inequality in the world and also in countries, I guess. Like I looked at income inequality in the world, but like partly for the reason that this data on wealth inequality is just problematic. Like we have huge problems figuring out what the wealth distribution is in a country like the UK or in the US, where recent papers tell very different stories about what is happening to the wealth distribution in the US. Some countries, some papers report, like Piketty's last paper, together with Gabriel Zucman, reports very rapid rising wealth inequality in the US, while other papers don't find this increasing trend. And if it's true for like the best researched countries in the world, then it's definitely also true for the world. So that's one reason why I'm a bit skeptic about these Credit Suisse reports that are now so hotly debated in the media. But also these reports show that over the last 15 years, if you take a bit of a longer perspective there, then global wealth inequality seems to fall, although I'm skeptical that we know much about the global wealth distribution at all.
Thank you very much. I'd just like to ask Anders to pick up on something you said, which was that technology and the speed of technological advance, that's an enabler, if you like, and that yes there are challenges, but we've managed them in the past. Now that's where one tends to look for comfort and consolation, but the argument being put at present by the those who would see doom around the corner is both that the nature of technological change is very distinctive now, and even more so the speed is just very much more rapid than we've seen in the past. That the nature is very different because it's essentially eroding jobs much higher up the income distribution, So it's not just hollowing out the middle, but it's actually going further up the distribution than that, and that it's happening so quickly that our capacity to cope and to adapt is enormously challenged. So against that background, what would be your primary source of optimism in terms of thinking how we're likely to deal with this?
Well, I would like to point out that word enabler. I think that's important. Technology is an enabler, but it doesn't tell you exactly what you must do. Certain technologies certainly lend themselves very well to it. If you have a pen, you will tend to write or draw something because that's the nature of what pens are good for. They're much less useful as hammers. But you can use a pen as a crappy hammer. And similarly, the technologies we have, they're interesting because many of them are general purpose. What you can use a computer for is both sending cat pictures over the net and organizing your community group or trying to run high-frequency trading. And you can invent something new. A friend of mine said the cool thing about Bitcoin is that I can invent new financial institutions in an afternoon, which is both a very cheerful and a very scary thought. So these technologies, are they moving faster than ever? And I wish I could say yes or no, but I don't. If you think it's problematic to think about inequality data, it's really tricky with technology. In some cases, like Moore's law, we have something to measure and we can make rather nice plots, and they actually do seem to show acceleration. In some domains, you can look at performance curves, like how much energy or effort does it take to make a certain industrial chemical. And typically we see improvement over time, but in many cases, not at all as radical as Moore's law. There are some technologies that move much faster than others. In fact, there are some people who argue, most famously Kasparov and Peter Thiel, that maybe we have a stagnation in technological growth. Yes, we're getting awesome things on Facebook, but that's a distraction. It's not as fundamental as an interplanetary rocket. Now, it would have been lovely for me to be able to prove them totally wrong, but it's hard. In fact, technology seems to be qualitative in a lot of its development. It's not just that we can do much more quantitatively in some domains. We also discover new domains we didn't even know about. So in the case of community, for example, we probably have a decline of strong social links. But thanks to Facebook and similar tools, we have a way of maintaining enormous sets of extremely weak social links. Whether that's a good or a bad thing is debatable. It probably depends on who you are and how you make use of them. So I think there is something interesting going on. I think there are some technologies where we can clearly say they're accelerating to a large degree, and we can see that they feed into the trends that will transform society. I do think automation is probably going to transform our occupational world over the next few decades quite faster than we have ever seen before. And that's going to cause a lot of interesting responses, because in the past it was routine mechanical work that tended to get replaced, and those people didn't have much voice. But once the upper middle class managers find themselves replaced by a rather short piece of software code, they have voice. They are definitely going to want something done. So I think there is plenty of opportunity for hope here, because I think working less in the long run is exactly what we should aim for. We should aim at getting rid of work. We might need to figure out how to distribute things. We need to figure out how to handle this autonomous system, which can be quite dangerous on their own. But I also think we have new ways of organizing ourselves. We have new ways of getting exposed to new ideas. I think one of the best antidotes to the inhomogeneity of modern society is that you get exposed to other people. It might take one or two generations before you get used to people of different colors or weird sexual preferences or really weird political views or views on science. But I think we actually will, in the long run, become a more tolerant society. It's just that we need to survive that process.
Thank you very much. Yep.
Thank you. It's obvious that many of the forces that are at play over this 50, 60 year period are global rather than national. And therefore I was really interested to see that graph in the first presentation from Max about the change in income in inequality over, I think the graph was the last 100 years. The very marked difference that graph showed between continental Europe and the English-speaking countries the latter being in that very strong U-shape, is so striking that it must have attracted, I would imagine, quite a lot of study. And I wondered if someone could just maybe just briefly tell us what the main outlines of an explanation could be for that marked difference in the English-speaking world, when some of the forces, at least, that have contributed to it are obviously global.
Sure, thank you. We'll come back to that.
Just a comment to the panel of men. Nobody has mentioned gender equality. I remember 1957, my mother was in the kitchen all the time. My husband does all the cooking. And I think there's been a shift that hasn't been mentioned yet.
Nobody will argue with you there.
This is just a question to the first speaker, briefly. You mentioned that there is a connection between increasing democratization and decreasing deaths by ground warfare. I don't know whether you meant to make a clear connection there, but I was wondering if you can also consider for us, I guess, outright, whether nuclear deterrency also has contributed to decreasing deaths by ground warfare. And I suppose also whether, I mean, you mentioned slightly also about nature, but there's an increase, you know, global warming's an issue, and there's a lot more humans on the planet. So I'm wondering how we can balance equality with not turning on all the cars in a parking lot and suffocating together equally, on whether true equality and also keeping the planet, you know, alive might require all of us to turn our engines off. I guess what you think about that.
Okay, I'll take one more if there is. Yep.
Professor John Geddes at a Torch seminar stated that 1 in 4 of the world's population has a mental health issue. As someone with a mental health issue, could you please put your conjoined cooperative efforts together in speeding up less work and more play?
Okay. Max, do you want to take the point about that contrast between the English-speaking?
Oh, yeah, that also. I guess that's exactly the point why I, like, that's exactly the point I wanted to make, that there, that this increase of inequality in the English-speaking countries and the relatively modest increase in other countries suggests that it's not all about external forces, not all about globalization or technology that affects, that should affect every labor market similarly, but that what is at work is something that is happening at the national level, and that inequality very much is a choice, really. I think the explanation for this discrepancy across countries is that that political forces are at work, whether it's the bargaining power of workers or it's the labor market and tax system that is affecting that. And I guess one obvious pitch there is that my boss here at the university, Tony Atkinson, just wrote a book exactly about this question. The title is Inequality, What Can Be Done? And he takes the perspective over the last 100 years and tries to see what we can learn from the periods where inequality was falling how we can change the income and distribution, particularly here in the UK. So it should be over there in Blackwell's Inequality, What Can Be Done? Then there were these questions about democratic peace and the impact on the environment. I think about the environment, like it's obviously like a combination of each individual's impact on the environment and then the number of individuals on the planet that is multiplying this this individual effect. And we are decreasing CO2 emissions per unit of prosperity, but this process is happening much too slow, so we have to speed up this process. And at the same time, the world population is increasing, but this increase is now slowing down. So if you take this perspective against over the 50 years, then the peak of population growth was around 57 or a little later, where the world population grew by 2% per year, and it's now approaching 1%, I would think. So that these two forces are slowly decreasing the impact of humans on the planet, but we're clearly not where we want to be there. And then you were asking about this link between democracy and peace and possibly nuclear deterrence and peace. I think the question about nuclear deterrence is something for Anders. Like the fundamental problem is, of course, like that we just don't know. Like we don't have the counterfactual. We don't have a world to experiment with, where we have no nuclear powers over this 50-year period. So I find it a bit hard to think about this question and about the link between peace and democracy. I think the general idea there is that if you have an autocratic regime, then an autocratic ruler has little to risk when he puts his population at war and sends his troops out to fight a war, and has a lot to gain personally. So the autocratic ruler is willing to sacrifice the population for his possible personal gains. In a democracy where these decisions are made by the population, it's the same people that make the decision and that bear the risks of going to war. And I guess that's the general idea of this democratic peace theory. And we have evidence that two countries that are both democratic are much less likely to go to and fight wars with each other.
Thank you very much, Max. I wonder, I'd very much like to support Max's reference to Tony Atkinson's recent book, which has some very striking and stimulating thinking about what one can do in to address rising inequality in a country like the UK. But just to go to Robert on that, you were saying that the focus groups are now what guide political action, and that certain mindsets and attitudes are hardwired. Was the expression you used. Now, if that's the case, how does one go about trying to change the underlying attitudes? And how optimistic would you be about the chances?
I have to be optimistic. I've been on the interface between policy and academia for 40 years. It's the only way to keep going is to be optimistic, but I am profoundly pessimistic on this particular score. And I really, really don't know. In fact, the book I've written on poverty and shame raises this as a major quandary, because it's not just a UK experience. It's replicated throughout much of the world, even in countries which you might argue. So countries such as Uganda, where we worked in rural Uganda, these distinctions between rich and poor, which are expressed in moral terms, are profoundly important everywhere. Education, I suppose, leadership, attempt to challenge the language that we use and the way that we think. We've made films and movies in an attempt to do that. We put storylines into soap operas, trying to challenge those views. I am deeply pessimistic, but on the other hand, the optimism. I do believe in governance. I have the optimism that we can use the resources at our disposal collectively, and I think that's where we have to put much of our emphasis. Many of the questions were relating to global, and many of the issues, of course, that we deal with are global. And the obvious answer is that we have to have global governance. The transition of how we get there is, of course, a challenge. We had your wonderful graph about treaties, the role of civil society in policing governments to abide by those treaties is something that we hope can develop over time. But equally, governance is to address the inequalities that Tony Atkinson is encouraging us to think about. And that inevitably, you know, in the time when MacMillan was talking, you notice that the doing something about it was to come from growth. It's easy to redistribute new wealth. It's much more difficult to redistribute existing wealth. But at a global scale, that's what we have to do. How we get there, I don't know.
And I mean, I think we can take some comfort from the fact, first of all, that attitudes were different in the past and can be again, and that we've seen a sea change in attitudes, for example, to mental health problems, where the whole understanding is radically different now. And I think that's very, very widespread. I saw another hand.
Because the mental health issue is actually quite interesting. Yes. if we go back to 1957, we would find mental health treatments, of course, horrific. Mm. Yeah. And enormous improvements have been done, especially, of course, in the case of psychopharmacology, which is still very crude and not really doing what we want. But it's way better than what we had in 1957. One interesting fact is that if you look at the amount of money people are willing to give to research on cancer versus the brain, well, so this much to cancer and this much to the brain, and mental illness, of course, even less. While, of course, the burden is kind of opposite. Yes, cancer is nasty, but compared to the mental illnesses, it's actually relatively easy to handle. But this is because, again, of this cultural perception. What is the problem? What do you want to stand up and support? And I think one of the interesting things is how much culture has changed. So again, gender equality is an amazing example, yeah, how much has shifted. So I like to point out quite often that a time traveler from 1900 going to 1950, he would be astounded by the technology, but the social mores would be fairly familiar. Going from 1950 to 2000, well, he would recognize the technology fairly well. The television would be in color, but that's the main difference. But the social mores, whoa. And that is something good. Absolutely. We can change our social mores and culture. We can. That's actually our software. It's way more flexible.
I profoundly agree. And had the coin gone to heads rather than to tails, you'd have got that story. In 1957, I cried when I learned that my mum was going back to work and she didn't go. And I've carried that guilt ever since. So I think I think that's right. And I would have gone through these lists of social and cultural changes, which I think have been profound. But many of them, you think about ethnicity, you think about sexuality, you even think about gender, they were led by those who had voice. And the achievements have been enormous. The same is perhaps true of mental health too. There are advocates of mental health, you know, in the media, in places where they can be seen and can talk. And I again think the change in 57, there was an enormous institution which was 7 miles from away from our house, which the community was frightened of. So this is profound. But how we capture the particular group that I want to deal with, who by definition are disadvantaged, have lack of resources, are not in a powerful position. In that case, we have to find advocates on their behalf rather than generating that momentum from change from within. And I think that's the challenge that I haven't yet thought about how we can solve. We used to have a trade union movement, but the sociological underpinnings of the trade union movement are no longer there. We haven't got those mass industries which you can so easily mobilise. But maybe again, we can think about technology in terms of replacing trade unions in a way, but then to think what power they might have to wield, to bring to the table, to negotiate, to persuade change to occur.
Thank you very much. I did see another hand there. So there's one here and then one. Mary, yep, so here and then behind.
Thank you. In some respects, I think the population were better looked after in 1957 than they are now. Ophthalmology was under the National Health. Dentistry was under the National Health. Care of elderly was under the National Health because we were looked after in geriatric hospitals, which continued up until the mid-1980s, when they were closed, and that four dreadful words, care in the community, were introduced. Also, in 1957, if you were clever enough to go to university, the state paid for your education. People were, there was full employment. People could buy a house on a modest income. And people tended to marry much, much younger, 25, start a family, and buy their own house. Can anyone do that nowadays? No.
Thank you.
Picking up on the point about the level of inequality being largely a social choice and the issue of social attitudes being, as we now see them, hardwired, what to me is a huge puzzle is how come, as we saw last week, what are relatively homogeneous populations between those north of the border and those south of the border can find themselves with such radically different attitudes to essentially austerity and the implications of austerity and the groups who are going to be the groups who are being particularly hurt by austerity. And I think on the globe, well, we acknowledge that there are a lot of English-born people who are living north of the border, there are lots of Scots like myself living south of the border, there are lots of mongrel families in the UK, of whom my family happens to be one, and yet we can see this tremendous bifurcation I struggle to understand what the sources of this are, and in particular, which trend is going to be the more powerful.
Okay, if there's one more, I'll take it. If not, I'll go back to the panel. Yep, just here. Sorry, just, yep, this, exactly.
What would the panel think about the state taking up responsibility for employment and financing full employment, like something similar to what exists in the States in the 30s of the WPA? And does that begin to solve both poverty issues and shame issues? And would it get around the thinking of the median voter? Because if you solve the problem by employment, then there isn't the shirking issue.
Okay, just a quick crack at that one myself, in that that's actually one of the proposals in this book by Tony Atkinson that we were talking about, that the state offer employment, a guaranteed employment at the minimum wage to anyone who hasn't found employment in the otherwise, but as an option rather than as an obligation, which obviously affects how the median voter might think about it if these views are as hardwired as Robert is suggesting. So I think I'll now the very important points made here. I'll give each of the panel an opportunity to just respond or say the last thing that they want to say in terms of reflecting on what they've heard and what they've thought as they've been sitting here, and then we'll adjourn next door for some refreshment. Robert, we'll start with you and take it.
Okay. On the left. I'd like to believe government can deliver in that way. And again, one looks to Scandinavia, where employment there's a virtuous cycle of high levels of employment, much of which is provided through the public sector. I defer to economists in terms of the effect of externalities and placing global society. And government has at the moment got a bad name. So somehow we have to perhaps change that. Whether we can become all Scots, I don't know, but you're right, it's a fascinating difference. And it's not a new difference. You enter a general election, all the general elections, you go to Scotland, and it's an entirely different culture. And we think in different ways. There's a sense in which historically, disadvantage has been more widely shared in Scotland. Because of the higher incidence, higher numbers of families have come in touch, even if not directly, whether that's a force or whether it's in a sense the nationalism itself which builds that commitment as a nation to work together. Yeah, I find it fascinating. I don't know anybody's done any research. They must have done some research, but I confess not to have read it. I focused in my talk on negativity and change, partly because I predicted my colleagues would look to incredibly positive developments, and there have been wonderful developments in many ways. Would I want to live in 1957 again? Probably not in all honest terms. But would I want to be my son now? With the burden of his housing compared with mine, I would have done that sort of comparison. So I think it's a complex story. And I suppose I have to just make a statement of faith that we're all intelligent beings in this room, working together. It seems to me that we should be able to both respond to the challenges, many of which we create collectively, and use the resources that we have at our disposal to respond to them, but to build the infrastructure that enables us to do that, to re-engage with that notion of, well, maybe I can share, and maybe I can share some of my resources with others of a different colour in a different part of the world. I think it's an amazing opportunity. It's amazing. I regret getting old. I'm just about to, in a sense, move out of the academic world. I'm desperate, because you know my politics, I'm desperate at the conclusion of the election, that's the legacy. And this negativity, this us and them, is a legacy that my generation passes on to the next. But my eternal optimism suggests that my children are better educated, your point. They are much more intelligent. Let's accord them the hope that they can bring about the change that our generation worked with technologically, but didn't work with morally and socially.
Follow that, Anders.
That's not gonna work. Yeah, I just agree with your point there. Would I want to live in 1957? No way. The computers were so slow there. and of course, there is something other. It was a much more closed world. You had a Cold War, it was very clear, us and them, and then there was a few woozy places like Sweden pretending to be neutral, but actually being quite cozy with NATO. What has happened since then is it's a much more open world. It's a messier world, and it's much more complex. And I think one of the problems we have today with our policymaking is simply that, yeah, there is so much going on, but it's very hard to cram that into any proper decision-making system. You need a lot of levels of filtering to turn that into something a politician or a civil servant could even start to understand. And during all that filtering, the biases creep in. And that's where you start using the focus groups, because at least they give you something actionable. I think we need to figure out better ways of handling this multipolar, messy world. Because an open world is an amazing opportunity, and I think we should really take that. So I'm rather optimistic about the future. I'm worried about loads of disasters. At our institute, we're very good at doom and gloom. But we're also rather happy about the future. We think that it's only kind of 12% chance that we go extinct this century. But there is way more chance that we actually turn this into an awesome century. And again, we have the tools, we have a lot of people of goodwill, we have more people of goodwill, we have people of different neurotype or gender who are also able to participate, and I think that can help. Because when dealing with problem solving, typically having a diverse group helps much better than having a homogeneous group.
Thank you very much. Max?
Yeah. Just to connect it to what Robert was saying and what we've been discussing with this focus on the UK, I very much agree that it is unacceptable how the poor are treated in a country like this. And it also links to the story of growth that I was telling, because I think one advantage of telling an empirical story of how income has actually increased over these 60 years is to make clear how much easier it should be for us today with these high levels of prosperity to actually be more generous and to redistribute and to help those at the bottom of the distribution. So it helps also in this perspective. Then, like generally, I guess I was taking a more global perspective on the change since 1957 and was actually asking how does the world today compare. And If we're again asking this question, would I have been rather born today or in 1957? It's also clearly yes. Like if we have this like Rawlsian veil of ignorance and don't know where we show up on the planet if we are born today, then the chances of being born at a higher level of health and education and less violence and more openness and better access to information and education that you were mentioning, then it's clearly much better today than it was 1957 on a global level.
Thank you very much. Well, we've bitten off a rather large topic, and I think you'll agree that we've had enormous food for thought and stimulation from our three speakers. I'd like to very warmly thank them again on your behalf. And of course, to thank you for coming and participating so very actively, and to invite you to join us for some refreshments next door. Thank you very much.